Okay, here we go. 0 days left. Saturday was the big day. The Camp Wigan Water Extravaganza was about to begin. Everyone went right to the pool to hear Mrs. Nelson's final instructions and get their costumes. Mrs. Nelson began talking. "Now, children, I'll read the story over the camp loudspeaker. All you have to do is listen carefully and follow my instructions." As if on cue, cars loaded with parents, brothers, and sisters of the campers started arriving. They parked and were immediately greeted by a welcome committee that piled them with a flower lei and then invited them to the pool area for a play to be performed by the campers and staff. Janie and some of the girl counselors had ridden into Santa Cruz the evening before, to everyone's enjoyment, returned with boxes full of magnolias. They worked all evening making leis. The surplus flowers covered the pool in bright exotic colors. Parents conditioned to strained greetings were delighted. Family children accustomed to pampering or resenting their handicapped brother or sister found themselves wishing to be in the play. You could see smiles flash across the faces of the hosts. Pirates and natives waved to their bemused families. The excited and curious audience was directed to take seats around the pool. Mr. Bradshaw was late to arrive with a delegation of trustees behind him. He faced a play about to begin. There was only one thing to do, join in like everyone else. Well, at least the pool was clean. It even had flowers. Mrs. Nelson approached the microphone, papers in hand. She started to narrate and direct our water epic. Once upon a time, an ugly pirate ship, that's you, Mr. Jones, sailed a ship, the USS Acorn, in Camp Wigan Lagoon. The pirates with Mr. Jones were a villainous lot. Well, look, mean, you pirates. That's right, stomp around, show off your eye patches and swords, shake your fists at the natives. Good. The peaceful natives of the lagoon were a powerful and beautiful people. They simply chided, that's make faces, and taunted the pirates. The pirates, angered at this show of disrespect, pointed to their skull and crossbone flag. Finally, the captain of the pirates stepped out onto the gangplank. That's the diving board, Mr. Jones. No one said pirates were smart. The captain of the pirates, a ferocious braggart, declared that he had came for the treasure in the lagoon, and that nothing would stop him. To get the treasure, he challenged the natives to a contest. It would be his pirates versus the natives. May the best group win. Given this order to act, I pranced about, looking all over the natives straight in the eye. Then I walked about, displaying the muscles and strength of my fellow pirates. In silent movie fashion, I was overly dramatic. I know, because the audience started booing me. Imagine me, the most viral of pirates, being booed. Most of the kids got the idea and started posturing and posing. Spider and Morton played natives. When I passed each of them, I lifted my eye patch and gave a pirate wink. They laughed in retribution, shook their acorn necklaces in my face, taunting and teasing. I tried to encounter each of the pirates and natives. I paused by each player to make some kind of gesture or salute, giving everyone a chance to receive some applause and recognition. The audience was fantastic. They got the idea and warmly greeted each of the players. The stage was set. "All right, Mr. Jones, that's enough," called Mrs. Nelson. "The story must go on." And so the pirates challenged the natives to a contest of strength and wisdom. The first event of the contest was to dive for treasures. With this introduction, Mrs. Nelson pulled a box from the girls' dressing room with a heave, dumped the contents into the pool. It was the camp silverware, every last knife, fork, and spoon. Returning to the microphone, Mrs. Nelson calmly continued her narrative chatter. All of the treasure collected and piled on the poolside, Mrs. Nelson continued her story. The treasure was taken to the native temple of Ola, where it could receive the blessing of the god Ola. "Okay, you pirates and native dancers, you heard me. The treasure was taken to the temple. That's it. Good. Now the only way the god Ola would release the treasure was with the satisfactory performance of the legendary water ballet." Given this signal, the pirate and the native players who had practiced roving around the pool were placed in their respective inner tubes. From the various edges of the pool, they kicked and splashed into the center of the pool, where they formed a large circle. Then, with the orchestration of Mrs. Nelson, the circle was pushed in a clockwise and then counterclockwise maneuver. The audience clapped in appreciation. It was hard. Kids like Benny wanted to go fast, while kids like Aaron and Thomas were doing all they could just to keep afloat. Each had to show a great deal of tolerance. The circle move was followed by the formation of a floating star, and then the division of floaties. or floaters, into two lines. It was a Virginia reel on the water. The gods must have been happy. As the water ballet ended, Mrs. Nelson proclaimed that a final contest would mark the end of the water extravaganza. With approval from the god Ola, the treasure was to be given to the winner of the race between the captain and the pirates. That's Mr. Jones and the best native swimmer of all time, Spider, the unconquerable. It was obvious that the corresponding booze and adulation that Spider was the odds-on favorite. To build up for the big race, some of the pirates and I did evil-looking dives. The natives countered with their own dives, actually. We had several kids who thought big splashes were the only appropriate act for such a play. With the completion of the dives, the race was about to begin. Mrs. Nelson began explaining how the contest would be fought. According to the ancient tradition, Spider would be allowed to start first. The swimming start is to offset the fact that the captain of the pirates is known to cheat and use gangplank as a diving board. Are you ready? Will someone help Spider get ready? All right, on your mark, get set, go. In the midst of a great roar, Spider was off, surging and kicking with all his might. I watched carefully, trying to calculate when I should dive. I knew that a running dive, even done with lots of wasted motion, could carry me a fourth of the distance across the pool. I also knew that to Spider, this was a race and it wouldn't be right to not go all out. With this in mind, I gave a pirate yell and dove headlong after Spider. I came up and spotted Spider, perhaps halfway down the pool, with exaggerated but sure strokes. I quickly began to close the distance. I could hear the crowd yelling frantically for Spider. Faster, faster, come on, Spider. Just a little past halfway. I drew abreast of Spider. I hesitated, trying to think what to do. To roll over and backstroke. To dive underwater, perhaps, and swim the distance out of the public sight. I was now a clear body length in front of Spider. I heard a yell. I looked over at Spider. With a jerk, he was out of the water. In fact, he looked like a rock skipping over the water surface. He was alongside me and then past me. Faster and then faster. I started swimming with all my might. Spider was cutting across the water at an incredible speed. I couldn't catch him. The crowd was ecstatic, like a one-sided... tug of war. The natives had tied a rope to Spider and in unison were now beginning to pull him down the pool. He was bouncing over the water toward the end of the pool. With all my might, I couldn't reach the edge and stop this rush. Everyone was yelling. Just as Spider was about to be yanked right through the poolside, the rope went slack and coated to the side like a surfer on the wave. Spider had won. The race, the summer camp, the companionships were ended. Quiet moments of goodbye. I was reminded of our first meeting, a silent exchange. Now it was taking place again. Children, the precious bond to life, were being passed from counselor back to parent. It was quiet. Benny rolled slowly by himself from our presence. Spider was passed from arm to arm. Martin walked holding my hand. He was leading. Thomas Stewart had to be carried. His eyes were a little older and sadder. Aaron wanted to push himself, show his parents his strength and his acorn necklace. For many of the girl campers, the farewell was of special significance. They had become young women. One carried a hidden crush. The word filtered to me like a breeze. Several girls broke from the goodbye with parents and hurried to the pool. I felt very embarrassed by this rendezvous. They pushed and prodded one of the members forward and then vanished. It was a close friend of Mary, the girl Aaron had given his necklace to. She was equally embarrassed yet demanding of the situation. She had enjoyed summer camp. Loved my voice and enthusiasm. Thought I was a good pirate. Wanted to know if I would write. Wanted to hold my hand, touch my face. I held her hand very gently. She asked me if I would close my eyes. If I would be at summer camp next year. If I would say goodbye. With a kiss, I bent down and touched her lips with mine. I would be here. I would remember summer camp forever. This unexpected moment took me away. I didn't even see the members of the Acorn Society leave. I think they knew and even approved. They understood and felt many things I would never comprehend. They were racers, mountain climbers, observers, and kings, and they were dying. Most wouldn't live past the teen years. And here is the epilogue. All the principal children in the story are now dead. Dominic and I kept in close touch with these children for 5 years. Dominic's connections with the mafia turned out to be more real than story. With money from legitimate business and lots of volunteer help, Dominic and I conducted trips for these friends in an annual Christmas party. Thomas and Aaron died 1 year after summer camp. Spider was killed by a car the following year. Martin died in a car accident 4 years later. Benny B was the last child to leave the place. Of all the children, he was the only one to have a funeral. At the final service, Benny's mother gave me a white envelope. Inside was a crumpled acorn necklace. She said he gave them to everyone he met. Remember, this was a true story, nonfiction book, so all real events. Keep that in mind as I ask you to reflect on the ending of the book.